Alright, so while I'm trying to get the microphone to work, I will hand this off to whoever wants to start off. One of the things I noticed from last Thursday's class was a lot of you didn't listen to my instructions, which is speak clearly into the microphone so that it comes across like the voice of God on the recorder when you're doing this, so it's not coming across. So there you go.
Don't worry about that.
Okay, guys, we were supposed to go on Thursday. However, I know the suspense was killing y'all, but we're going today. My group is Fine Wine, Austin Meyer, Emily Nelson, Kaylee Winkler, Tyler Corson. How many of you guys have a job? Show of hands. How many of you absolutely love your jobs? How many plan on keeping that job for the rest of their life? No one? No? There you go. Okay, that's good. So, how many of you guys would just absolutely love to tell your boss to shut it? How many of you guys want to make a difference in someone's life? Make some extra money on the side, maybe work from home. Anyone want to do that? Well, today we're here to talk to you guys about multi-level marketing and potentially joining my organization.
Alright, so how many of you actually know what multi-level marketing is? Alright, so a few, that's awesome. Has anyone ever bought into Herbalife or the Mary and Kate products? If you have, you know what multi-level marketing is. That's the question that we're discussing today. Is my section is about the ethical dilemma of multi-level marketing and the difference between that and a pyramid scheme. Multi-level marketing is essentially you start with an organization, you recruit new members, and you just stack up and keep on earning money by having new members recruited to join and discuss and sell the product. The difference between that, a multi-level marketing organization and a pyramid scheme, however, is defined by James Muncy by five questions. The first one is, how is the money being made? If it's just simply just by adding new people and they just keep on recruiting and recruiting and recruiting and using the profits from the membership fees to make a profit for the organization, you might be in a pyramid scheme. The second question is, are the products legitimate? If you're selling the actual product, you're in good hands. Third one is, how much does it cost to be involved? If there's a price that you have to pay up front, you should be a little bit wary of it. Doesn't always mean that you're about to buy into a pyramid scheme, however. The fourth question is, how much work is required? If it's just buy into a company, sit at home, and then you just watch the money roll it, you're probably in trouble. And the fifth one is, how long has the company been around? Like any good and potential employee, you should look into the company, see how long it's been around. If it started up last week, you should be a little bit skeptical of it.
All right, I did the earnings and income disclosures for these companies. So what I looked at was these companies can actually be extremely profitable. For example, Road and Fields averaged 93% revenue growth from 2010 to 2015, and they grew their revenues from $24 million in 2010 to over $627 million in 2015. So we kind of see this like explosive growth in revenue and sales for these companies, kind of like a honeymoon phase, and then eventually tapers off or even goes down. Herbalife also experienced some pretty impressive growth, growing from about $2.3 billion in sales in 2009 to almost $5 billion in 2014. But we've seen that this rarely actually translates to profits for distributors or individual consultants. A Forbes study of 17 of the largest multi-level marketing companies found that only the top 3% of distributors make more than minimum wage on an annual basis. And that number is actually probably a little bit lower. It doesn't take into account the expenses they incur during this process. Doesn't really look at the time that they put into this. And so with the income disclosures, this is kind of their attempt at being transparent. Some of these companies do post annual income disclosures. The data is often pretty misleading due to the income ranges or the averages they use. They deem a lot of salespeople ineligible if they don't have a downline and make a certain level of sales. So that pretty much eliminates their lowest performers from their entire income disclosure, making themselves look a little bit better, but the data really not being that realistic. There's no real way to gauge the time invested, so we don't know if someone's making $20,000 a year, working 60 hours a week, or working 20 hours a week, or really that time effort that they have to put in to reach that level. They also do not include the expenses. A lot of these companies, all of these companies are direct sales, so typically they have to stock their own product. For example, LuLaRoe, who sells women's clothing and bright, colorful stuff, it can cost $4,000 to over $10,000 to start up one of those, which is just a huge expense, and really the profits aren't rolling in from that. Go to the next slide. So this is an example of an income disclosure. This is for Plexus. Something we always see with this and during the recruitment process is this top line where, you know, there's some type of life-changing product and rewarding business opportunity, and there's going to be personal success, financial stability, potential, so on and so forth. So they're kind of throwing this idea out that this is a great opportunity. But these numbers aren't really that realistic. They're based on averages for a given rank, and we do see that 98.65% fall below the average of $12,276 a year, which is a little bit below working full-time in minimum wage for a year. We also see that these numbers only include ambassadors, so they're kind of scrubbing their bottom line by excluding their lowest performing salesmen. And it says, like, later in the disclosure that associates are classified as individuals who did not meet the qualifications of an ambassador and did not qualify to earn monthly commissions. So you really don't know what that is other than they're not included. It does disclose that their ambassador's only income is $1,885.99. And when you include associates into that, it's $111. So that's really, they're losing money on an annual basis. And also, there's something interesting that's in almost every single one of these disclosures. It says that your success depends on your effort, commitment, skill, and leadership abilities, and how effectively you exercise those qualities. So they're kind of saying, it's not me, it's you. Which I think is kind of an unethical way to guide your salesman and your company. Let me go to the next one. And this is for Roden and Fields. With their numbers, you see a very large income range per level and low averages. So, for example, the level 3 EC, their low side is making $2,427 a year. Their high side is making $91,000. Like, you really can't really get a lot of information from this. But you do see that the average of all consultants of that is 1%. And so for them, it's less than 3% that's making above minimum wage. And this data is only for paid and active consultants. This disclosure didn't include who else is excluded or what those qualifications are. It does say that the average income for all active consultants is $3,182. That might sound like decent if you're just, you know, putting in a few hours a week, but none of these numbers include expenses. And I know Roden Fields has some really expensive products, and if your margins aren't ginormous, you're really not making a lot of money at all. And also, it does include the it's not me, it's you disclosure, saying that it results from sales efforts and hard work, diligence, leadership, and how effectively you exercise these qualities. So the next one. And so for the last one, this is It Works. It's a little bit different. They showed monthly income statistics. Their included numbers are only for people with downline commissions, which I guess is they have to have people below them to be included in these numbers. The average monthly income for all distributors is $189. Which is pretty rough when you factor in these expenses that are incurred with, like, direct sales. and buying your inventory. And this one actually has a pretty decent disclosure about those expenses, saying that it could cost several hundred dollars or thousands of dollars annually. So I guess several hundred is on the low side. So really, it seems like a lot of people are making losses when they're presented with this opportunity that's not a real business opportunity. So with all these companies, we see that the distributors aren't really making that much. The expenses aren't included. They're kind of promoting this idea of financial freedom and potential to be an entrepreneur, when really a lot of this income is going towards buying those products and kind of securing your own customer base. So it seems pretty predatory. You kind of have to be really right at the top 0.something% to make money, and typically those people are the ones that have been in the company for the longest. And this one actually kind of shows that with the monthly company on the far right, showing that, you know, it can take a long, long time to reach those levels of actually being profitable. And so next we're going to talk about the legality of this.
Okay, so I looked at different legal cases. I only chose a few because there are quite a lot out there against these companies. The first one I found was a young woman who had been taking Herbalife and had started having problems with her liver, and she actually had to be hospitalized for it. And she stopped taking the products and got better, so she just assumed that the illness was over with. And when she started taking them again, she started having more problems. And so when she went to her doctor, he informed her that she needed to stop taking the products immediately because some of the products had contained over 10 times the amount of lead in them that is legally allowed to be in those products. And so it was a bunch against a statute, and they did a couple journal articles over it to inform others about it, but that was really all that was done with that. There are some super simple ones like the Adidas and Herbalife, and then that one they got sued for the three-pronged leaf being on their products because Adidas has their trademark on it. FTC versus Burn Lounge. Burn Lounge was a company that people could sell music off of their website for as independent distributors. But the FTC found that they were a legal pyramid scheme because most of the way that their independent resellers got their points was from recruitment, not from actually selling the products. So because that was the big way they got their points, they were shut down for being a legal pyramid scheme. Swedberg versus JewelScent. JewelScent's a big company that sells wax starts, beads, soaps, body scrub, body creams, and all that. And in each product, they include a ring that's valued from $10 to $7,500. But if you find a golden token, you can email the company the code that's on the front and back, and then you get your choice of a special piece of jewelry that's ranged from $100 to $7,500. And they were accused of running a lottery system because of including the different jewelry and all the pieces. So she sued them for that, but it got dismissed. And then Primary Children's Medical Center Foundation was sued by Sensi because of trademark infringement, because they use terms like festival of trees during winter times. So a lot of these cases were really simple, trademark infringement, but some of them were more serious, the Channing Herbalife case where she was hospitalized because of liver problems, and she wasn't the only one because of that, and so that's why they put it in journal.
So we talked a little bit about the weaknesses of multi-level marketing. So I think it's really important to kind of focus also on the strengths of multi-level marketing. One of the biggest ones is their close connection to their consumer. Another group demonstrated that everybody in this room has a Facebook, and according to Facebook.com, over 1 billion people log on to Facebook every day. So multi-level marketing companies are really taking advantage of this use of community and are doing things like Facebook groups to bring in this community, promote themselves, group messages, to be able to promote these products as well. And they're also using Facebook to bring in their community in a social way as well. So having social gatherings in their home. This seems to be pretty effective because the consumer really, prefers a really personal consumer experience. And a lot of people prefer to go to a consultant that they know and care about rather than go to a distributor that's pretty large. The next one is the commitment to recruitment and mentorship. So like we talked about before, recruitment is really important in multi-level marketing. And with this, their strength is once you recruit someone to become a consultant, you become their mentor. And every person has their mentor. And this is pretty effective because everyone feels really good about how they're starting their business, can kind of, it's a continuous training, and it's really good to be able to learn different things without the company. If there are new strategies, it's a really good ladder way to get the information spread amongst the people. And this also helps with retention within the company. If they feel like their hand is being held, they're less likely to be unsuccessful. And then this really just instills the confidence in the employees to be able to be successful in business. And then the last one is really self-empowerment. And this is something that multi-level marketing companies really promote, is being your own boss and building the entrepreneur. It really focuses on the people within the company. So helping each other be successful in advancement in their careers. And I think many businesses would really focus well on company culture. Their businesses would thrive a lot more as well. So it's really important when we're looking at multi-level marketing strategies, if you're getting into this kind of opportunity, to both look at the pros and the cons of each company, do your research, and find the best thing to do for you.
Thank you guys so much. Does anyone have any questions about potentially joining our firm?
What ethical theory would support multi-level marketing?
In the article that James Muncy released, it wasn't really discussed the theories of it. Does anyone in the group might have a comment on that? Yeah, that one's lost on us. Sorry about that. But we do find that in the article that Muncy published, it was published to the FTC's website, and so we found that it was more of a guidelines for them to be able to regulate and defer whether it was a multi-level marketing organization or a pyramid scheme. That was the main focus of the article.
So, with regard to the five questions that you have to ask, is that an elements test or a factors test that would tell you whether or not you were dealing with a pyramid versus a multi-level marketing? What I mean by the difference in the types is, an elements test would say if you meet every single one of these, if you could say that, for example, the money is being made primarily by membership, that the products are not legitimate. An elements test would say you have to meet each one of these things for it to be considered a pyramid scheme. Is that the case, or is it a balancing test among these that they say?
It would definitely be a balancing test between them. If there may be one or two that may not be checked off on that, so it would have to be just a case-by-case basis on that front.
Okay. Is Amway a pyramid scheme or a multi-level marketing?
I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with that organization.
Usually, with what I've seen on the court rulings and stuff in similar cases, they've had to pay fines for certain things that they've claimed, but at this point they're still operating legally.
What about Mary Kay?
Mary Kay, I believe, is considered a multi-level marketing simply because in a lot of cases they do offer a legitimate product, though with most multi-level marketing it is a gray area in a lot of regards.
What about Arbonne?
Again, Arbonne, just like Mary Kay, has that legitimate kind of product that they're selling. And I think that with that company, they're getting a lot more of their profit from their sales rather than from their recruitment.
Yeah. All right, very good. Anybody else have a question? Number five. Good presentation. I like the PowerPoint.
Didn't come from Oliver Stone. So later, he found out that he got hacked, you know. He sent out a warning to everyone saying, you know, hey, got hacked. My email's been compromised. And basically, this was considered a weaponized document. Now, that happened only a month before the wider Sony hack that the FBI had said was done by North Korea. So, with this new revelation, more than 170,000 internal emails by Sony Pictures Entertainment had been compromised. So basically, with Amy Pastel being the victim of this incident, you know, it was a spearhead phishing. And basically what that is you know, when you open up an email from somebody that you think you know, and you click on the link that they have provided for it, a lot of bad stuff happens, you know, potential spearheads, spear phishing, excuse me, files being written to the disk, and listener software set up to the device. So, Sony was concerned about this early as June of 2013 about North Korea's retaliation because of a movie called The Interview. You guys know it, remember? Okay, so basically it's a comedy about two guys going to assassinate Kim Jong-un, you know? Even though we know it's a comedy, you know, can you imagine being in another country with a different culture, you know, what your sense of comedy is versus what ours is here? So over there in North Korea, their cyber attacks team is one that's called Bureau 121. And then they also have a larger branch, which is Reconnaissance General Bureau, which is commanded by Kim Young-chung, which he is a former bodyguard of Kim's father and grandfather. They've invested 5 years of cyber attacks prior to 2014. And they did trial runs in South Korea, their banking, their news source. The cyber attack analysts warned that cyber attacks like this is far from over with. You know, and any adversaries that we have, as far as like North Korea or Iran, could possibly be a big threat for us to deal with. So as far as brand-wise, did this affect Sony? I don't think it did. I think it was free publicity in the sense of, like, you know, let's talk about aside from the movie. As far as like works that Rogan and, you know, the budget that they put in the movie. The budget for the movie was $44 million, but their box office was only $11 million, so they only got a quarter of what they actually put into the movie. So, yeah.
All right, I'm going to start talking about collaborative companies, and I'm going to go over what is collaborative companies, give you some examples, and why it can be a challenge for some marketers. So what a collaborative companies are, just companies that collaborate together without us knowing, and they usually do this to just get a big stranglehold of the market that they're in to help them out. A great example of this is Apple actually buys parts from Samsung to their for their phone, and not a lot of people know that. Why do they do this? Apple does it because Samsung, I believe, is their semiconductors that they buy from Samsung. They actually can get those super cheap while still having top of line quality from Samsung. Why is this a challenge? Who actually owns a phone other than an Apple or a Samsung? A couple? Three? Everybody knows Apple and Samsung are the top two phone providers in the country right now, probably worldwide too. This creates just a big competitive advantage that they're trying to compete against other ones. Whatever, it's just mainly against Apple and Samsung. A great example of this is Actually, let me talk about raising barriers to entry. Doing this creates just new companies that want to enter the market. It's really hard for them to do because of this big competitive advantage that Apple and Samsung have. A great example is the Google Pixel. It is a great phone, don't get me wrong, and it's got some great features on it, but I don't think it's going to be as big as Apple or Samsung just because of the name brand. And Google has the money to do it, but I don't think they can accomplish something that Apple and Samsung has already done. And another example is why it's difficult to market. Talking about LG, they released their G5, I think a couple of years ago, or last year, I can't remember. But it fell halfway through its debut because Apple released their new phone, and it just failed miserably. And it's really hard to market to these type of markets that companies have, these collaborative companies just dominating the market.
So I had customer centricity, and basically customer centricity is the sense of putting the customer at the center. Creating customer value and really putting the customer first results in long-lasting business, but a problem that companies face is being familiar but new, or in other words, innovating themselves. Many companies have a hard time building on their initial advantage without changing the product completely to something the consumer isn't comfortable with. But in order for a product to win in the eyes of the consumer in the first place, it must have superiority. Superiority is huge when it comes to companies. Companies do this in various ways. A popular way is products having a design that buyers can easily recognize, such as distinctive colors. Another way is designing for habit. For example, Google Maps rules the habit of people trying to find somewhere to go. Without superiority, a company has nothing to build on in the first place.
So the one I have is the hunt for talent. And as a marketer marketing your business, the question or problem that arises would be, how do we attract really smart, really great people to our business and keep up the right structure? And I think the answer to that is like adaptability. It's something that's a skill that you have. It's not easily learned, being able to adapt to the environment you're in within the changing market. I was at a career fair this weekend, and the guy I talked to for a company about internships, he was saying that, I asked him the question, like, how do you know which intern to hire after college if you do hire them? Like, what are you looking for? And number one thing he said was, do they fit within the company? Are they willing to, like, first, are they well-liked? You know, you have to be able to like the employees and everyone within the company. But also, are they willing to learn, and do they fit within the company? And so that's one thing that I think actually applies to all of these and really draws them together is, are you able to adapt? The second thing is the willingness to learn. Used to when you get hired, they base it off of what you know or who you know. So the knowledge you learned within school, or maybe you knew someone who knew someone who got a job, and that's how you got that job. Now it's more of, are you willing to learn? For example, I had a speaker that came into a finance club meeting, and he worked for a bank, I believe in the loan department. And one of the things he said is that when he was interviewing a person was, were they an extrovert? They were looking based on their personality rather than what they knew, because he told us that whatever the job was, they can teach them that, but that specific job, they were going out to clients and talking to the clients about a different situation. So they wanted them to be an extrovert and be able to communicate with them so they would be well-liked. So that's one of the things he said, like, we can teach you what you need to learn, but we want you to be an extrovert. So that's one of the things that they're looking at, and like, how do you, as an interviewee, how do you go about that? And I think it all relates back to, again, being able to adapt. Always learning and continuously teaching. As college students, I think we once we graduate that we're done learning. That's not right. I think once you graduate college, do you guys still have to continue to learn in order to be successful within your career? I had a professor that told me that her dad is a doctor, and once he graduated college, he continued to, I think every day he'd go into work early and look at magazines and different sources on how to critique his technique in different scenarios, and was continually learning, because he's a surgeon, and that's one thing he was always willing to do, was continue to learn how to get better within his field. Also, she also had a friend on the flip side who had the mindset of once he was done with college, that he was done learning, and that didn't work out to him for so. That didn't work out for him. He learned, I think, after a couple of years, that you have to be able to learn once you graduate college in order to be successful within a career. Is it? Any questions?
What is a weaponized document?
Weaponized document. Oh God, it's malware. from what I saw, North Korea had, they had 112 different types of malware coming from 45 different families. Spybot, cookie.
Okay, so there are various ways of hacking. What makes a weaponized document different from other hacking?
Intent. What makes it different than other ways of hacking?
The way the DNC was hacked is very, very simplistic, wasn't it? How was the DNC hacked? Anybody know?
I know.
Yeah.
Somebody sent email saying, "Hey, you need to change your password," and he did.
Yeah.
He tried to change
his password. It was the easiest hack.
It was John Podesta.
It was the easiest hacking of all kinds. So that's really, it's an interesting thing. What do you think for those of you who wanted to do collaborative companies?
Yeah.
Isn't it interesting, you didn't talk about the fact that Apple sued Samsung.
Yeah.
And Samsung sued Apple right back for patent infringements. Yeah. They have these patent wars going on, so how are they collaborating?
I mean, just the fact that they can buy parts from Samsung so cheap while having still this top-of-the-line quality that Samsung has is kind of working together under the table.
What's the biggest example of collaborative corporations? Do you know? Marketing?
I tried thinking of tried doing Google on YouTube, but I don't know if that would be collaborative because they technically bought them out. But what other video service is there other than YouTube, and Google has a hold of that too?
It's actually Intel Pentium inside, and nobody cared what their chips were until Intel decided to have a campaign. And so they collaborate with all the companies to put the sticker, like Dell, to put the sticker that says Intel inside.
Yeah, on every computer.
Yeah. All right, very good.
Thank you.
So, our team name is Queens of Heart, and we did yet another presentation on big data. I'm Emerson Hart, by the way. So the big question is, what is big data? And big data is an evolving term that describes a large amount of semi-structured, structured, or unstructured data that has the potential to be mined for information. It is also defined as an ever-increasing volume, velocity, variety, variability, and complexity of information. So what does this mean for marketing organizations? This means that basically the market is flooded with all this technological advancement, so they're kind of forced to use big data in order to stay ahead or even stay on par with other companies that are using it. So this is kind of a consequence of advancements in technology.
So I did why big data is important, and it's not so much the data that's collected, it's how you use the data that you collect. And most companies that use big data use it for gathering information for cost reduction and time reduction, use it for developing new products, as well as making smarter business choices on how on using it. It also affects higher profits. Big data also helps companies to funnel the information faster. So when companies use big data, they use it to gain that information and the knowledge about their customers, and then use it to figure out how they can assist their customers and how they can provide assistance to their customers better.
All right, some of the benefits of big data have to do with customers. So big data, it has algorithms and softwares and analytics that use the information input, and they're able to find who their customers really are, like how frequently they are buying products, where they're located. And this allows companies to make better adaptations to basically like making promotions and giving out like sales and discounts on products that they know that are growing quickly. And from this, they're able to build new opportunities. Just like they're finding products and customers that are growing together, and they're gonna like make a new opportunity out of that, so they can get more new products out there.
All right, there's several companies that are already integrated into the data network. There is Amazon, General Ledger, Netflix, and Capital One. Amazon uses its data to go ahead and gather all the customer purchases and information to be able to select different items, similar items that they can use to market to the customers. General Electric, they use a type of sensor into their products that allows them to, you know, review and look at all of their information that is sent back, and allows them to be more reliable on their services that they send to their customers, and allow them to set up another structure of their next product that they're going to come out with. Netflix. Whenever Netflix originally first started, they only had four different data points, which was the customer ID, the movie ID, the ratings, and the date the movie was actually watched. So from that aspect, that didn't really work out for them. So whenever Big Data actually came out, it actually helped them out a lot more, to where they were able to find out the time of the day that the actual, the time of the day that the actual people were watching the shows, how often they were pausing the shows, how often they were browsing, what they were browsing. They were able to actually do more of a viewing habits to know exactly what to promote to the next, next client or customer, and make their system a lot better set up. Now, Capital One, they use data patterns to better service, you know, demographically. They're able to sort their customers out to where they can do pricing and services a little bit better, you know, based on the country and area that they're actually in. So it actually works out a little bit better for them, and they've been using it for years. There's other different type of businesses that actually use different type of data sets, and it's not all about purchasing for this one. Now, in the medical field, they actually use it to cross-match patients' information so they can actually help out with symptoms. You know, if somebody has like different types of symptoms, they're able to match it with other people to actually get, you know, their prescriptions for them, make sure that they don't actually have any problems with it or any type of side effects. So it actually helps them get a lot more data to, you know, cross-reference these patients' information. The sports industry actually uses the big data to collect information, and they're able to use it for the different players they want to recruit. They want to actually bring into their team, and it's a lot easier for them to be able to see what position that they can work for and everything. Now the educational system, they actually use the big data setup to help them provide services for a lot of the students that are in their colleges and educational systems. They try and figure out the people that are falling behind, you know, about to drop out, you know, and try and do what they can to help them out, to customize more of a list to assist with more of the students' needs to be able to get them back up when they're not dropping out or doing any type of, I don't even know the word for that one, but it just basically they help out the student to assist to get them back up to a good higher level education. And a lot of people have noticed a lot of benefits getting switched around and actually helping out more with the big data set, able to increase more of the higher education on that one.
So I'm going to cover big data challenges in marketing. So let's take an example of you are the industry and you need to take some information from your customers. So which information you need to have is like the name and your contact detail that allow you to market directly to them. Also let you make communication personalized. You may also need to contact them if the order is running late or something like that. Also, you need to have the transaction history that indicates user preference, which product they most likely to buy and when, and how often they're going to buy them. Also, the communication from you and the customer. You need to keep record of this to make sure your space out of communication correctly. Also the profile, like the age, the gender, the profession, income, hobbies, and so on. So that can be useful for more marketing strategy. It allows you to better focus on your advertising and marketing efforts. And also, knowing the age and the profession help you with the price strategy. Also spending, you need to know the spending habit of your customer, like how often the customer shop, if it's someone who shop all the time, per month, or one time per year, or also on a special occasion, everything like that. And also you need to know the birth of your customer. That can, like, you can have some, a good relationship with your customer, you can send him a text message or a gift card. Also, you need to know which tools to use. So for that, we have qualitative and quantitative data. So for the qualitative data is sometimes called categorical data because the information can be grouped by category. And for the qualitative one, is the one that involves number and everything like that. So I'm going to give you some example of qualitative and quantitative data. So for the qualitative One, we have documents, analysis, serving, and for the qualitative one, we have interview, focus group, observation, and case study. So the last part is the part is when you are, like how you put the data you collect with your marketing strategy, like how to use all of the information you already collect and make it and make something with that. So that the big data develop key marketing and science. So big data deliver objective information that can help reduce uncertainty, create predictive models, and craft data-driven solutions. Also improve marketing decision. So big data provide real-time insight on what your customer has enjoyed, as well as who is buying what and when. Also, big data better engage customers. It provide telling insight into customer, which will allow your business to personalize the customer experience with relevant and timely special offers, product and service claims. Also, create a marketing workplace by consolidate information from business area like sales, staffing, and inventory in a centralized manner that can prompt from decision about marketing, supply chain management, operation, labor, and more. And the last one is that big data can boost the bottom line, which with more substantial business insight, including a better understanding of target customer, workplace efficiency, and customer needs, your business can secure revenue and also reduce costs.
I'm V, and I did concerns on big data or future concerns. The first one is violation of individuals' privacy. That's the biggest one. The collection of what you're doing online, what you're buying, all of it goes to a cloud. And basically, they're invading your personal lives, what you're looking at. The second one was focusing on too much analytics causes a disconnect from customers, and consumers become a number instead of a customer. So companies would focus more on their sales and profit instead of building that relationship with their customers in order for them to come back. They just want their profits. And then another one was employees' ability to read the collected data and analyze it either wrong or right. An example of that would be a company might look at a demographic collection of data, and it could be a town is making money off of supermarket sales, and then a company might open maybe a Ulta makeup store, and it's just the reading of wrong data. Another one is that companies can rely mostly on data collection, and that can cause a problem. I mean, it's technology, we rely on everything from technology, so data collection is probably another one that's gonna be up there. And then some future possibilities is that the data volumes will grow tremendous in the future. I mean, it's no doubt that it will. And then the ways to analyze it will also improve because technology grows. And a challenge in the future, and even now, is the privacy. As big data grows, they're gonna get more into your privacy, and we just have to accept that, because companies rely on big data now and more companies are using it. So it's just our way of accepting it now. And then big data can also provide a job opportunity, as in like a job opening. We can now have a data manager maybe in the future, that's a possibility. And then, so, and we think that big data, most people see it as a bad thing because of privacy, but we think it's good. Technology grows and we should just grow with it. I see it as a good thing. It can help in healthcare, schools, like Crystal said, just different places.
I had one question. Most of the people focused on privacy, you all focus, at least two of you, on cost reduction. How can most people focus on the privacy and they think that you can generate revenue based on big data and they don't think about the fact that you can do cost reduction. So how can you do cost reduction with big data?
Well, I think a big point is that you can avoid markets to where you might lose money. So if you're some companies that don't rely on big data for sales, like if they're not looking at markets, instead they're looking at getting that personal information to market them online. If we were talking about opening like physical stores, a company that's not looking at the demographics or the income level, they might just throw a store in there and it might fail and close down. But if you're looking at the data and you realize this is a good market or this is a bad market, you can avoid costs by just avoiding markets altogether.
And also, GE, you know, when you were talking about the products with the sensors, you know, they actually review most of their data that they've received from these products to better understand of what they need to fix prior to just throwing something out there and creating new products that will mess up in the end. So basically, they gather the information to save on cost, you know, to allow them to better their product.
We are Group Versatile, and my name is Jenna Partee.
My name is Bob McLean.
My name is Keely.
My name is Brett.
And my name is Matt Curry. So today we will be reviewing false advertisement. False advertisement is known as deceptive advertising. This is when a company publicly advertises their product in a misleading or confusing manner, such as providing false statements about the product to entice their customers to buy more.
In today's PowerPoint, Group Versatile will briefly discuss the following 3 points: the laws and backgrounds of false advertising, examples of companies participating in false advertising, the effect it has on the company's consumers.
Okay, so I'll be talking about the laws and backgrounds. There are federal laws that are supposed to protect against false advertisement, and that includes anything that's advertised on a billboard, in a magazine, on TV, radio, talk shows. And the FTC is the one that enforces these laws. So if you are investigated by the FTC, they can freeze your assets, they can take you to court, they can have you pay a fine to all of the victims, you can publicly apologize. And on top of the laws that we have in place with the FTC, we also have guides. And you can't be fined with a civil penalty, but you still need to follow these guides. And some of the guides that we still have in place include the funeral guides, the endorsement guides, and the green guides.
On prevention, the Federal Trade Act, businesses cannot mislead or deceive you by words or conduct, make false or unsubstantiated claims that have no evidence or proof, or use unfair sales practices such as pyramid selling and fake advertising, which I think one of the groups has already spoken about. By enacting these regulations, the FTC helps enforce companies to not engage in false advertising.
So an example of false advertising was a couple of years ago, back in 2008, Dan and the yogurt and dairy company, they claimed that their yogurts actually helped regulate digestion and boost your immune system. But in fact, it wasn't scientifically proven, and it wasn't approved by the FDA. So they were taken to court by the FTC, and they were ordered to pay $45 million in fines for false advertising, and then they also had to relabel and rebrand their yogurt. They couldn't put any more, say that the yogurt was beneficial to your health.
Okay, so last week, Mary Kay filed a lawsuit against RetailMeNot because RetailMeNot was soliciting coupons without Mary Kay's consent. Mary Kay sells her products in a direct sales method instead of selling directly to the customers, therefore claiming that RetailMeNot compromises their sales method by offering online coupons for Mary Kay's product. This is false advertisement because by listing these coupons, RetailMeNot misleads the customers to believe that the two companies share a relationship that allows RetailMeNot to sell products at a reduced price.
So the Red Bull Energy Drink Company, they had got into some trouble. It started in 2002 when they came up with their very popular slogan, Red Bull gives you wings. Well, a little over a decade later, it turns out that Red Bull actually does not give you wings. Therefore, resulting in a very smart customer to take Red Bull to court and have them pay numerous amounts of settlement money to the customer, as well as having to reimburse every customer who's paid, who's bought a Red Bull since the year 2002.
Another example is Sensa Incorporation. It's one of the winning companies that sell weight loss products to consumers. That they advertise to people that they will make them lose weight when you consume their products. But it turns out that the products that they consume does not have any effects on their body. So that people sue for a massive amount of money. And some of the products cause like health effects too when you consume it, even though they say that it's supposed to be healthy for them when you consume stuff. So it'll be EPA free.
So another example of false advertisement is Volkswagen. They got a little scandalous a few years ago and claimed to be eco-friendly and go green by reducing the nitrogen oxide emissions of their vehicles. However, when they did their tests, they tampered with those, in particular those cars, so that they could pass the test. But then a few years later, a university did some extensive research on them, and they found out that it was just those cars and every other car vehicle on the road was letting out up to 40 times the legal limit of nitrogen oxide, which is illegal. So then they pay numerous amounts of settlements, EPA, to the commission board, as well as their customers. They had to either fix their cars or trade in a vehicle and get them a new one.
Okay, so engaging in false advertising has many negative effects. And some of the negative effects can be that companies have to actually pay the victims and publicly apologize, and then the company can be taken to a court of law. And by the company's image being damaged, they can lose more money, and they can lose their customers, and nobody really wants to buy from them anymore. So, unfortunately, consumers lose their own money as well. They lose their time. They thought maybe that they were helping support that company and helping them get off the ground, and that maybe they needed some assistance.
In conclusion, Group Versatile has discussed general information, the laws on false advertising, ways to prevent it, and examples of the companies participating in that.
Any questions? So, is it enough to just disclaim being a bad? So, for example, lots of companies say, you know, this is not intended to treat, cure, or prevent any disease, although they make claims. Is that good enough?
No.
You don't think so?
No, because sometimes it may not be visible enough, or consumers might just throw the label away, so they're not really looking at it.
Doesn't the law say that's enough?
It does.
To just disclaim?
Yeah. But I think that they could do a little bit more.
What about things that have gone through the FDA? It turns out that a lot of drugs that go through the FDA actually have no greater impact than a placebo. And yet they have FDA approval, so isn't that misleading?
It is.
And it's government approved misleading. How do you deal with that?
You don't buy it?
You
don't buy it.
Consumer has to do the research.
Ethically, right. I mean, it's not the right thing to do, but at the end of the day, it comes down to the consumer.
Okay. All right. Very good. Do you want to try and go, or do you want to go Thursday? Is this long? Okay. Well, we can wait till Thursday. If you present it today and you dress up, be sure and take a picture and put it in the Dropbox so I can give you your bonus points for those of you that did that. So you guys want to wait till Thursday? Is that okay with you all? Okay. All right. We'll finish up on Thursday. Hopefully, if we have to run over Tuesday, we can have one to Tuesday. Good job on the presentations today. Thanks. If you didn't sign the roll sheet, be sure to have it signed it if you make it to you.
Wait, where are we going? Right here, real quick.
Red.
Very good.
And then AMA is meeting April 19th.
145 on the register.
Why didn't she say it?
Somebody, anybody missing?
That was from last class.
Okay, I will take it. Thanks.
Thank you.